Anyway, thank you for coming out. This is our 31st noontime talk. My name is Elizabeth Turenik, and I'm the Director of Planning and Development. The last 3 years have been extremely challenging and frustrating, but also incredibly rewarding based on my experiences with the community. The community has an incredible spirit, and I'm always inspired by the actions that are being taken. I don't know about you, but I'm feeling like a lot of the decision-making that's happening in the city is a bit beyond our control, not necessarily being made by the community, but really affecting the community. It's frustrating for me. I'm sure it's all frustrating for you. And so how do we really make a difference? And there are a lot of things that are going on in the city that are action-oriented. So I was very lucky to go to a conference last month. It was actually a requirement of a grant we received. It was fully grant-funded. And it was about grassroots organizing and community action. It was extremely inspiring. And I thought, enough meetings, enough plans, how do we actually make things happen in the city? And how do we support each other in doing that? So I see a lot of neighborhood groups that are going to speak today, a lot of grassroots organizations that will speak today to tell you what they're doing and how do we do more of it. Again, it's getting us out there and actually accomplishing. And I can say on my behalf that I will do anything that I can to support those efforts in the city. I just want to recognize some folks in the audience. We have members of our zoning board, Anthony Vrame and Sharon Aloy, who are very dedicated decision makers on the zoning board. They do a great job. Freeholder Alex Marino. We have Director of the Housing Authority, Cliff Scott. Councilman Kaleem Shabazz, who will be speaking today. District Commander from the state, Tom Gilbert. And I really appreciate the decision makers that are in the room today and all of the efforts in working together. So we're going to start with Councilman Shabazz. He's going to talk a little bit about the history of activism in Atlantic City, just to let you know that we are carrying on a tradition that has been a very important part of the city. Councilman Shabazz?
Good afternoon. I was excited when I saw all these people. I thought you had come to see me, but then I saw that you really came to see Elizabeth or Al Thomas. So I am glad that to have a couple of minutes, and I won't be long. There's always a temptation, and Alex Marino can tell you the feeling when you have an elected official come before a crowd of people to make an extended speech. So I will fight that temptation very strongly and not try to make an extended speech. But with regard to activism and community organizing in Atlantic City, let me say that I've been on both ends of that divide. I've been a person who has been fortunate enough to organize people and advocate for change. And now I'm on the other side to have some ability to make change as an elected official, and much more after this year's over when we get a new governor and we have the ability to make change as elected officials in Atlantic City. Atlantic City very recently had a gentleman, some of you are too young to even remember, but you can Google it, the first African-American elected mayor in the city of Atlantic City was a man named James Ushery. And James Ushery came to be elected by the coming together of a group of community organizations called the Congress of Community Organizations. And the Congress of Community Organizations had done very similar things to what each of the community organizations who have done here, advocate for change in their community, present proposals, come to city council, write letters, have meetings, bring in elected officials and air their concerns, to the point that these groups came together and said that they needed to impact the electoral process. And as a result of that, they came out with a consensus candidate. And that consensus candidate at that time was James Ushery, who happened to be a local educator. He had formerly been a professional basketball player. He came back to Atlantic City and had a long history of being a teacher, a assistant principal, then a principal, and was really sort of I don't want to say a crossover figure, but he was a crossover figure before people said that people were crossover figures. And he ran for office and he won. My point in saying that is not to say that you need to pick candidates, but you need to look at candidates and people who are running for office and ask them, what are they going to do about the questions that concern your particular community, your particular group? That's the concern that those of us who are elected look at. We balance, obviously, the concerns. Now, our particular situation is a little different than hopefully the situation we're going in the future because we have state oversight. And I won't relitigate that question again, but you must know that those of us who are elected feel very strongly that that was the wrong move to have the state take over financial functions in Atlantic City to the extent that they prohibited elected officials from having the ability to make decisions. I want to be clear about that so people don't think that trying to put a false picture on our realistic situation. We realistically understand that Atlantic City has severe financial problems. You don't have to be an accountant to know that. You don't even have to be a government official to know that. You look at the our balance sheet, you look at the deficit, you look at the structural imbalance, so you understand that. But we take a strong position, and we're even backed by the Republican candidates for governor and the Democratic candidates for governor, that the state should not take over a local municipality. Having said that, I think it's important going forth that you not revisit so much the history, but utilize what you see as contemporary issues in Atlantic City to help those of us who are making decisions make better decisions. We need more citizen input. We need more people to speak out. We need more people to use the levers of communication that we have today that we didn't have 20, 30 years ago. Seth, don't tweet. Please don't send me any tweets. We really do need to hear very seriously from average citizens, from community groups, your thinking, your insights, your goals, your remedies for some of the problems we have. Just because you're an elected official, I don't care what level you're on, that doesn't give you any special power or any special ability. It gives you a special responsibility because you have to act on the behalf of people. And you have to use your best judgment to make decisions. So you have that special designation, but it doesn't mean you're smarter than anybody else. So we need that. As I come to a conclusion, I see Liz getting ready to give me the hook. Let me say I'm encouraged by Atlantic City. I go places and people talk about Atlantic City. Obviously, everybody recognizes Atlantic City because we are a resort and the designation that people have heard about it. But we have a tremendous civic passion in Atlantic City. We have people from all neighborhoods, from Chelsea to the Inlet, all six wards. We have groups and people who are passionate, who do things like Ms. Dunson, Latoya Dunson, a citizen hero who does things in her community, like Dawn, who does things in her community. We have like Libby Uptown, who does things in her community. Ms. Garrett and her community. So we have the nucleus to do good things. Let me say, continue, don't stop, don't get discouraged. Reach out to your elected officials, let us know what you're thinking. And you utilize the ways of communication. Believe me, letters count. When you write someone who is elected a letter, not a form letter, let me say that in terms of organized form letters, they add up in terms of numbers, but form letters, people look at that and they have their staff and they don't pay attention to that much. If you write an individual letter or if you do an individual text in your own words, it doesn't have to be prose, it doesn't have to be that eloquent, but your own words to a problem or a position, that has an impact on an elected official. or an individual phone call. That has an impact on an elected official. No tweets. Those things have an impact. Thank you very much for your attention, and I'm going to stay around for the rest of the session, and I appreciate your support. And please, please, continue to believe in the Atlantic City. Keep X'ing the days off for when we will be free from the tyranny of someone whose name we won't mention, when we will have, and that's not a political statement. I see my friend Mike Lopez is here. That's not a political statement. That is a statement of social justice and civil rights. So we will have a different situation in a year. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Councilman. Councilman Shabazz mentioned neighborhood association meetings. He attends a lot of those, as does the mayor and other council members. If you haven't been to your neighborhood association meeting, it really is a great opportunity to have your concerns heard and also to collaborate with your neighbors about what your concerns are and creating a common voice. And also, how many in the audience have been to a council meeting? Unfortunately, me. That's an opportunity to also speak publicly at the beginning of the meeting. They do allow for public comment, and you have up to, is it 2 minutes or three?
Three minutes.
3 minutes to speak your concerns, and that is being heard by not only all of the elected officials, but also the directors, and if there's something that we need to address, we'll step out into the hall and find out your concerns right then and there. But of course, my door is always open to the public also if it's a planning issue. Okay, moving on. We have a lot of civic movements happening right now. I think I'm going to start with, you know what, before we do that, what happens at the end of the meeting is it gets to be chaos. There's a couple announcements I want to make. I have flyers up here for an event on January 24th at 6 p.m. It's an opportunity to lower your flood insurance if you're a homeowner in the city, and it tells you what documents to bring. You will be sitting one-on-one with a counselor to help you figure out how you can lower your flood insurance, okay? So if you're a homeowner, take that. Also, there's going to be an event sponsored by the Urban Land Institute about new development practices and revitalization in Atlantic County. And we have some local developers and smaller local developers that will be speaking there as well. Okay. So first we're going to, I think we're going to start with This Is AC, because they are a new organization in the city, and they kind of blanket the whole city. And they've really been doing some great work, not just by getting information out, but being active at events and actually organizing events. So I think we're going to have Evan Sanchez, Donna Danielson, and Dawn Villarmich.
You always do a good job. That's
okay.
A good job.
Come on up and fill us in on what you guys are up to. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for coming today. I'm Dawn Villarmich. I am one of the co-founders with Donna and Evan on This Is AC. For the most part, everyone looks semi-familiar in here, so I think a lot of you know the work we're doing. But This Is AC was really a community movement that we started in August of 2015 to shed light on the positive things that Atlantic City has to offer. So our entire mission is very simple. It's to highlight the positive. The real goal of This Is AC was to show the events, activities, and people that Atlantic City has and really flip the script on some of the constant negative attention that we seem to be getting. So to that end, we've really started a lot of events, we've piecemealed things together, and we are now a nonprofit organization. So we're really looking to spearhead some more events and really organize some things in Atlantic City that can help broadcast that positivity.
So there are a lot of great groups doing awesome things in Atlantic City. You're going to hear from a number of them today. Our goal is to really sort of work with those groups that are already doing cool things in Atlantic City, whether they're neighborhood associations, nonprofits, or for-profits, or whatever. But we look at ourselves as an umbrella group to sort of support these groups and promote what they're already doing. There are a lot of people that we've already worked with in here, with Joyce at the Arts Foundation, Buddy at the Lighthouse, different neighborhood associations, whatever there may be. The Wedding of the Sea from Ducktown. So there are all these different awesome things that are happening in Atlantic City. We want to promote them, so you can visit thisisac.com to find out what's going on in Atlantic City, whether it's a big event like Chris Rock at Borgata or a smaller happening like the Wedding of the Sea in Ducktown. You'll find sort of the breadth of what's available in Atlantic City. Also, we put on neighborhood association meetings, so all that information is actually at thisisac.com. In addition to that, we have a couple other features on the website. One of them is experiences, so we think that there are a lot more things that people might realize happening in Atlantic City. So if you want to put together a family-friendly day, you can do that starting in Gardner's Basin, moving down to the Lighthouse, going to Steel Pier, et cetera, et cetera. We also have what we're calling Faces of Atlantic City, which is profiles, and there are actually a number of people in here that have been profiled. So this is just highlighting, again, positive people doing great things in Atlantic City. So we want to continue to do what we're doing on the website, and we also encourage the community to use the hashtag ThisIsAC when they're out and about in Atlantic City, doing cool things, fun things, positive things. Use that hashtag so other people can kind of see that running stream of what's really happening in Atlantic City. And maybe Donna wants to talk about some of the events that we've helped to organize.
My day job, I'm with Tanger Outlets. We've kind of grouped people together to create major city events. Like the marathon had come in, the half marathon had come into the city. And people come in for the marathon and they leave and they don't really experience the city. So what we did was bring in Joyce and we had to talk about it with the families of the marathon runners. So they could chalk positive messaging on the half marathon course. We also worked with Bass Pro and the Noise Arts Garage to create discounts for the marathon attendees that they could use the weekend that they were here. So it's really trying to draw a whole experience for events to happen in Atlantic City, not just for people to come in, visit, and leave. We want to kind of broaden and expand their experience in Atlantic City.
And just piggybacking, we also have social media platforms, which is where we started. So we know most people are very into social media and its use. So we're on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. And really with those platforms, we send out a lot of the updated events and information that are also found on thisisac.com. So a number of different platforms that we are active on, and we really just want to encourage people to help us spread the positive message. It's mutually beneficial to everyone that we shed the positive light of Atlantic City. So the use of the hashtag and kind of following along with the work that we're doing.
So if someone has an event that they want to have you post, how should they get that to you?
You can email hello@thisisac.com with event information for anything that's going on in Atlantic City.
Yeah, and we'll email you back if we need more details.
So that's been one of the number one complaints I hear from both locals and people immediately out of the city is that they're not aware of the events that are happening. So something may be at Boardwalk Hall and they read about it afterwards in the paper. So we having a central location for not just big events but neighborhood and community events is huge. And I would just encourage everyone to use that and support the smaller events so that we can show a bigger movement. Okay, next I'm going to start with the civic associations, and one of the really cool events that happened in the past year but really didn't have as much participation that I was hoping was a bow tie event that was sponsored by the Ducktown Neighborhood Association. So I'm going to ask Stephanie Kleinman to come up and talk a little bit about Ducktown Neighborhood Association, that event, and other things that are happening that you're trying to bring forth, and then we'll have another person from Ducktown.
Hi everybody, I'm Stephanie Kleinman. I work for Stockton University. I'm the artistic director for Dante Hall Theater. Being located in the heart of Ducktown, we just recently put together, through the efforts of Bernadette Twardy, who couldn't be here today, the Ducktown Neighborhood Association. So we're brand new, we're in its infancy, but we are starting to build some momentum. Actually, last night was one of our best meetings yet. We meet on the third Tuesday of every month, and the locations vary in the Ducktown neighborhood area. But one of the first events that we had, Bernadette had identified that there was, it was an anniversary of sorts. I think it was National Bow Tie Day, and because our mayor is so well known for his bow ties and his fashion sense, we thought it'd be fun to put something together. And we actually worked very closely with members of This Is AC. I noticed you didn't mention Dante, but that's okay. We'll talk about it. No, we'll talk about it later. Anyway, no. But we did this wonderful event over at the Arts Garage, and we really invited everybody in the community, every neighborhood association, Chelsea, all the other surrounding ones. We wanted everybody to come out. We were trying to build like some kind of community camaraderie. We wanted to try to build some kind of even friendly competition with different, groups coming at support, you know, whose group had the most people turn out and different bow ties. We had performers there, the Peptones, and we took advantage of the beautiful art space at the Arts Garage. So building on that, we're hoping that next year, now that we've gotten it out there, it'll become a little bit bigger and we can grow upon that. But we're really just trying to make some strides in building more of a community, even with our separate community associations, having things that we can all come together with and enjoying the things in the city that mostly just the locals know about, but things that when visitors come, they're like, wait, this sounds really cool. And that's where This Is AC is instrumental, because you can promote that to the people who are coming in to visit. But other than that, we're just going to continue to build on that, and we appreciate the support that we've received. So thank you very much.
Also from Ducktown, I'm going to invite up Rich Negro. He helped organize the Wedding of the Sea Festival. And again, an event that brings together locals, but also is a great promotion of the city to people outside the city.
Okay. Thank you for having me. Three words: faith, persistence, and unity. We all have to remember this, because we have to turn things around in this city that we love so much. You wouldn't be here if you didn't care about Atlantic City, I'm sure of it. So I just want to clarify what's been happening as far as the parish of St. Monica is concerned, just to put that to bed. We've had, last year, a year and a half ago, we had some negative media publicity about the churches closing, what's happened to St. Michael's, what's happened to St. Nick's, what's happened to Our Lady, Star of the Sea, St. Monica's. Okay, there's only one parish now in Atlantic City, so think of it that way. However, the churches are still here. St. Monica's is a church, which will be sold, unfortunately, in the very near future. St. Michael's, a church. Our Lady, Star of the Sea, a church. And I think I didn't mention St. Nicholas, a church. Okay. Four jewels in Atlantic City, four churches, all part of one parish. So if you start to think about it, and I think I mentioned this last night at the meeting, what happens there? You have all this diversity now coming together under one parish, and you can tap into the Black Hispanic, the Black ministry, the Hispanic ministry, the Italian ministry, the Irish, whatever, are all coming together under one parish. So the emphasis is to do multicultural events going forward in the parish, to bring everybody together. We're all one, we're all the same, no matter what color, a rose is, it's still a rose. What we're going to be working on soon, because I know there's a lot of people who'd have to talk, so I'll try to keep mine to a minimum. The Wedding of the Sea. Father John Thomas is the pastor of St. Monica's. Okay, St. Monica's, even if it's sold, at least the parish is still here. The name of the parish is now St. Monica's. He's been the pastor now for about a year and a half. And when we got together with him, we told him about some of the traditions and some of the things we did in Atlantic City, like the Wedding of the Sea. And we used to have the big procession to the beach, the blessing, the mayor would come, throw the ring into the water, and everybody would get some water in a bottle and take it home with them, and then they would go back to St. Michael's Church, and there would be like a big festival. That hasn't been done in 15 years. We talked to Father John about that, and he said, let's give it a try. So last year was the first time in 15 years that we put together this event. With the help of Evan Sanchez and Cookie Teal, it turned out to be very successful. So what we want to do this year is start the end of this month. We're going to have our meeting to kick off this event. And we want it to be a signature event for the parish and something very, very big in Atlantic City. We have some great ideas. We have the support of the local businesses to move forward with this. And you'll be hearing a lot more about it as we go forward. We'll probably rely on some of the AC, mm-hmm. I'm new to this, but I'm learning a lot, and I'm not afraid to say that I'm learning. It's a learning thing for me too. But I've been involved now for a year and a half, and the people that I've been working with and trying to make these events possible, especially the multicultural events, it's been all positive, and we want to keep on going forward. I'll leave you with this. We started to have some masses at St. Michael last summer, and the good news is that we will continue this summer to have masses there every Sunday at 10 o'clock. I don't think the time will change because it seems to be working out fine. We'll be having masses there this summer. In one of the homilies, one of the retired priests, his name was Father Brady. I don't know if you know Father Brady or heard of Father Brady, but he said something that I just can't seem to forget. He talked about a farmer plowing a field. Okay? So he's plowing the field, and he's not looking back. He's looking forward. And as he went on to talk, he reminded the people, because this was one of the first masses at St. Michael's, and the people at St. Michael's were concerned about, what's going to happen to our church? He said, it's a good thing that I'm here today at this church talking to, presenting you with this homily. For one reason, it seems to mean a lot to everybody here. The farmer plowing the field. If he looks back, what happens? The ox may go in a different directions, and you're not plowing the field straight like you want to. So what you have to do is look forward. We can't change what happened in the past, but what we can do is look forward. Drive that ox straight. If you have something good going on, make it better. I'll end you with that. Just think about it. Thank you.
Thank you. And that was a great event. I was fortunate to attend both the Mass and the festival after, and you did a really, really great job. Okay, next I'm going to invite up Sheila Freeman with the Bungalow Park Civic Association. They have been very passionate about their community and in fact have been awarded a grant to do some work to organize their community. So, Sheila.
Hello, everyone.
Hello.
I'm pleased to be here today and glad to see the turnout that came out to talk about how we can improve our communities. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Sheila Hull Freeman. I'm with the Bungalow Park Civic Association. To echo something that Colleen said, we have to continue to believe in Atlantic City. And to piggyback on to some things projected by This Is AC group, we have to continue to promote the positivity about this city. All that being said, Bungalow Park is one of the oldest established neighborhoods in the city. It is also probably one of the smallest neighborhoods in the city. What is wonderful about what's going on in Bungalow Park right now is that we have an extremely diverse resident base. We were very unfortunate to lose a good percentage of our residents in Superstorm Sandy that frankly just haven't been able to come back, to afford to come back to the island. And the residents, we residents that are left there still believe passionately in the city and in our neighborhood. We think our diversity is something to be celebrated. And the diversity of our neighborhood and of this town is what makes it attractive to folks to come here, to live, to visit, to enjoy themselves. We were talking about what you could do in your community. There are any number of things that you as residents, members of a community association, can take the initiative to do. We were fortunate enough this past spring, under the guidance of Elizabeth Terenik, who's kind of my unofficial mentor in these civil things, made a connection for us with New Jersey Community Capital. And that group partnered with us to apply for a grant being given by the Neighborhood Works Institute. This particular grant was for Pride in Place, and as a civic association, we had never done anything like that. I felt strongly that we should put our best foot forward and go after it. because with the help and guidance of the appropriate city agencies and our city council, who I'm pleased to say we have a great dialogue with. Our councilman attends all our meetings if he's able. There was no better climate for us to make this move forward. And our neighborhood, frankly, is in flux. So it's up to us, because unfortunately the city loves us. I'm sure they love us. They take every opportunity to tell us that they love us. But they can't help us with the financial situation the city's in. Long story short, we partnered with New Jersey Community Capital. We applied for this grant because even though we'd never done anything like this as a civic organization, I felt strongly that we were as worthy of this assistance as any other community in the United States. Praise God, we won the grant. So it's not a huge amount of money, which would enable us to take care of some of the projects we would like to see done in our neighborhood, but it's significant so that we can express pride in our community. We've done things like begin to spruce up the Davenport Center, which is the building on New Jersey Avenue that we meet at once a month, second Thursday of every month, same as Chelsea. And in the spring, we're looking forward to doing more beautification around the building. It's going to enable us to go back to some traditions that we had in the past and that went by the wayside, such as our Family and Friends Day, which we have traditionally the week or week or two after Labor Day. We haven't had that since Superstorm Sandy. Also, welcome packages. Just a small little welcome package, maybe some candles, some flowers, some cookies, a couple recent newsletters that we could give to new residents coming in to our neighborhood. We're also going to refurbish our signage. We have a Welcome to Bungalow Park sign. I don't know if anybody has seen it here. I guess most everybody has. At the corner of New Jersey and Melrose or Mediterranean, whatever it is right there. We love that sign. We're not going to replace it. We're going to refurbish it. And we're also looking for new signage to be placed at the corner of Adriatic and Maryland, which Adriatic and Wabash have become almost primary ingress and egress routes to Bungalow Park since Delaware Avenue was shut off. Delaware Avenue was traditionally for years the main ingress and egress out of the neighborhood. So that being said, continue to believe in your community, in the city. Continue to accentuate the positive, because neighborhood by neighborhood, district by district is how we're going to get it done. We are also going to refurbish a mural which is on the wall between on Magellan Avenue between Delaware and New Jersey Avenues. We've found out doing some research that that mural has historic significance to our neighborhood. There is a dog on that mural that lived on this block maybe 30 years ago that was very protective of the children on the block. And everybody in the neighborhood knew this. We're not redoing our mural. We're getting it refurbished, refreshed, updated. And while we're doing that, we're going to incorporate a logo that was originally designed for us by a studio of Rutgers students who did a fabulous study on behalf of the city, but from which we benefited. So we tweaked the logo a little bit, but it's fabulous work that they did for us on every aspect of the neighborhood, where it is right now and where it can go. Again, we're going to try to do some of these things in that plan. Even though the city can't afford to do it, they love the plan. They've assured me they love the plan. So we're trying to do it piece by piece. And there's money out there in the world. And I said to my membership, who looked at me like I was crazy, why are we going for this grant? It's because some community in America is going to get it. It might as well be our community. It might as well be your community. So stand strong. stay positive, and keep coming out to Noontime Talk so you can find out what's going on in the town.
So again, the funding that was provided, it was a $25,000 grant from NeighborWorks, and an organization called New Jersey Community Capital that Sheila mentioned had been helping us with various things at no cost to the city, including our Abandoned Properties Act. They had done a lot of work. They're actually a lender in low-income communities, so they can be available for that role for us, for people that are trying to rehab their homes, et cetera. But that grant we will continue to pursue for other neighborhoods. The other source of funding is the Wells Fargo Neighborhood Grant, and they actually offer a workshop on their grant that we will make sure you all get information on. There's also funding that comes from the banks. They're all required to invest in the community, and it could be for housing or neighborhood groups and other opportunities that you as nonprofits can apply for that money. They also have a workshop to talk about that funding. So we will make sure, and if you did not receive an email from me, I'll take your email address and we'll make sure that you're always updated. We do have a website that we kind of broke out of the city site to make something a little more user-friendly. It's called acdevelopment.org, and we'll be sure to always post those kind of events on that website. Since we're talking about funding, and before we get to the Arts Foundation, I do want to invite up H&R Block, who's kind of a surprise, and they do have some funding available. So we're going to hear from,
Kim.
Hi. I said it earlier, but okay. Thank you, Kim.
Thank you, Elizabeth, and thank you everyone for having us here. I'm recently new from New York, and I just recently moved. H&R Block had relocated me here to AC, and a lot of people ask me in New York, wow, you're going to AC, you sure you're making the right move? And I've been here about 5 or 6 months, and I think I did. I know I did, especially now today about hearing all these stories. See, in the Bronx, where I'm from, when people have problems, they go to City Hall, but it's not the same. You're among thousands of people where you're not really heard. And I see here and I feel it here. In fact, I was just telling my manager, Nick, that my hairs were standing up. So excuse me if I get a little emotional. It's because when I first came here, I was thinking about retiring. I'm glad that I'm here because I can see my final days here. I do live in Elizabeth Knowles in the Roosevelt Beach condominiums where they're redoing the housing there for Stockton. And it's been now a wonderful experience. I do see it. In the behalf of H&R Block and looking around how we can be able to help the community, there's so many things that we can do. And I guess one of the main important things that we can be able to help the community is our nonprofit program, in which where we have our clients come in and they'll give the nonprofit code and we'll donate $20 for every client that comes into that nonprofit. So for an example, let's say we wanted to help with the Arts Museum, or maybe this is AC. When every time a new client will come in, let's say we give you a referral code 12345. They'll say, oh yeah, I'm here on the behalf of 12345, and we'll give you the signage, everything. You don't have to worry, you just sit back. We will donate $20. We have raised over like $4,000 or $5,000, even more than that, depending on the amount of clients that come in. Along with that, we also provide tax talks for free. And when I say for free, everybody says nothing's for free. This is actually for free because this is from the heart. The most important thing that we would like to do is to educate people here and to see how they can be able to make it in Atlantic City. For an example, when you spoke about the mortgage, there is ways that we can help reduce mortgage interest rates by just being more knowledgeable, energy saving things. We also have space available. If you need space to hold your meetings, we have spaces available, and I was talking with Nick about that. Chelsea has a big office space that if you need to have some of your constituents or some of your members come together and you need a place, you're more than welcome to use it for free. So again, please, I do have some flyers here. Reach out to us. We can do tax talks on immigration. I specialize on that. I specialize in military clergy. You name it, I specialize in it because this is my life. So thank you. Thank you for allowing me to live here. Thank you for giving me that faith that things will get better because I'm just getting used to the cold now. I was thinking, why is everybody wearing UGG boots? And now I know why. So please, again, my name is Kim Velez from H&R Block, and I work here at Renaissance Plaza. And I also work at Chelsea. My personal number is 609-892-8317. I will leave signage and my business cards here. So thank you again, and I will reach out to many of you nonprofits to see how we can help. All right? Thank you, and have a great day.
That's the kind of business that we really like here in Atlantic City, and thank you so much for all the things you're offering. And a lot of times businesses are willing to help, and sometimes they just need to be asked or organized, and we probably can tap them more moving forward. Okay, so next we have Joyce Hagen from the Arts Foundation. She is working with she's working on a lot of things, but there's also an effort. You're going to be talking about 48 blocks as well, and we have Lisa Honecker, the Dean of Arts and Humanities from Stockton University, that's here as well. Thank you for coming, and we're really excited to hear about what you have going. Lisa?
Okay, you can join me now. Well, I'm thrilled to see everybody here. Evidence of how much passion there is in the city to do some of the programs that we're talking about today. The Arts Foundation started in Atlantic City in June of 2015, and so we've just recently passed our one-year anniversary. We're very, very proud of what we've done so far. We have a wonderful board of directors, many of whom live in the city, others of whom are passionate about the city. And the programs that we've started, there will be one of them running behind me as I speak. There's no conversation with that, just some background music. So watch that, but listen to me, okay? And what you're going to see behind me is our first Chalk About AC, which we did in October of 2015. Chalk About AC was designed to be a community pride event, and we actually did something City Hall told us we couldn't do, and we put people creating chalk art in every ward of Atlantic City on one day and created this explosion of chalk drawings. One of the things I want to say about the foundation is I'd like to read our mission statement. It's probably slightly different than what you think an arts organization mission statement would be. The mission of the Atlantic City Arts Foundation is to foster an environment in which diverse arts and cultural programs enrich the quality of life for residents of and visitors to Atlantic City. So we all know that arts has been identified locally as something that we need to do, and we also all know that many attempts have been made by people who have been transplanted in the city, and a lot of money has been spent on the arts, and we are not yet the richer for it. And so this organization is a grassroots organization that has really taken a look at what offerings we actually do have in the city, identified what we think some of the needs are, and designed these programs to help accomplish those goals. So the first Chalk About AC, we had over 100 people register to create the chalk drawings. As you saw, there were little ducks drawn in Ducktown and just other positive messaging, like This Is AC is also communicating. My personal opinion is that the arts creates a level playing field for people to be able to create these expressions without any overtones of conflict or negativity. And so When we say arts, we don't necessarily mean fine art. We're talking about creative expression and just having fun with color and design a lot of times. Not that we are also creating opportunities for artists, as you'll hear about when I talk about our second program, but we really want citizens of the city to embrace arts for themselves, learn about the creative skills and talents that they have as individuals, appreciate the creative skills and talents that their neighbors have, and create a welcoming environment where people can express those things. And so that's what the Arts Foundation is all about. The other program that we've run several times in Atlantic City so far is Arteriors. There are two Arteriors videos on our YouTube channel, which is where you can find the Chalk About AC video that's behind you. And those also I would encourage you to watch. we're taking abandoned, empty buildings, not necessarily abandoned, but we're finding generous owners who allow us to take over their space. We're inviting local artists to create installations within those spaces that push their art beyond what they usually produce. It gives them an opportunity to work through an idea or technique that they've only dreamt they could do in a safe space, and we create that opportunity for them, then open up the Arteriors projects to the community for viewing and talking with the artists and meeting about the artists. We've had one on Tennessee Avenue, and we've had one at Formica's Bakery. We are nearly sure that we're doing one in the Ginsburg Bakery property in the first 2 weeks of April. And we have 8 artists who have agreed to do installations in there. And that should be, this will be our biggest and best so far to date. So that's a program where we are trying to call attention to the empty properties in Atlantic City, trying to encourage people to realize that there is transition in those properties. Some of the properties are for sale while we're in there. Other ones have been purchased and are awaiting a renovation for a new business. But it's still all that positive transition of property, and we're being able to have our artistic expression within those opportunities as our calendars and artists are available. So we're excited to say that we are also starting a 48 Blocks project that Stockton and the Foundation are partnering on. We will be visiting neighborhood association meetings soon. But the goal of this project is within the 48 Blocks concept, since we have 6 wards in Atlantic City, we're going to put 8 arts / creative projects within each ward on one Saturday in June. So what we're looking for is people who have creative energies, people who have artistic skills, who can meet with us and figure out locations where we want to put those projects and concept ideas of what those projects could be. This means if you know that you've got a young spoken word artist who needs a venue, we'll set up a little stage on a corner and give that person the opportunity to do a spoken word performance during that weekend. It means if you secretly play violin in your attic and you'd like to have a concert on your porch or your neighbor's porch, we'll create that opportunity for you. So we want to have all of these, we'll create a map of all the locations and a calendar of all the events, and we'll have a citywide party celebration of creativity and artistic ability within the city. I'm going to let Lisa speak further to that because she has some information I know she can add to that. I do have cards. The Arts Foundation, like every other nonprofit organization, always needs your financial support, but we also need excited people to serve on our committees and to just be involved in what we're doing. Follow what we're doing on Facebook, follow what we're doing on our website. We've got a .org, AtlanticCityArtsFoundation.org website. We've got an Instagram, lots of ways you can see what's going on with the arts in Atlantic City.
Again, I'm Lisa Honecker from Stockton. I'm the Dean of Arts and Humanities. We thought about the 48 blocks idea. I'd heard somebody just say that Atlantic City was 48 blocks, and I thought, wow, that's a great title for something. Then I met Joyce and Daryl from the Arts Foundation, and we thought that this would be an opportunity to do something that would stretch across the entire city and not simply be located in one place. Our ultimate goal is to make this an annual festival, and what we also want to do with it is to add art inventory to the city. Because of the timeline this year, we don't think that that is a realistic goal, but we've created a white paper and we are starting to talk to funders so that we're going to give it a trial run this year, and then hopefully next year we'll have grant funding that will allow us then to also, you know, create art that would be permanent. And we want to work with the neighborhood associations, as Joyce said, the ward councilmen, you know, anybody with civic interest to create these sorts of creative experiences all over the city. We have some ideas and we have some resources and we do have some funding so that we will, you know, at least be able to, we hope, provide materials and maybe some small honorariums for performers if that happens, so that we do have some money that we're going to try. I've been authorized by the president of Stockton to go forward with this, so I'm really hopeful that we can explore the creativity in each of the wards and come up with some with a day that will be a celebration in each ward, but also a celebration of the entire city. So we'll be showing up at your neighborhood association meetings with our white paper and our business cards. So if you're excited and you're interested, we're interested in you. So thank you.
And talk to the people in your neighborhood who you know do have talent. One of the councilmen contacted me after I presented at the council meeting that we were doing this and gave me names of 6 people who are artists in the city that I, after working here since the year 2000, didn't even know lived here. So we know that there's a lot of talent here, and we really hope that we can help it come out, and we can all then be able to enjoy it and give them avenues to express themselves. Mm-hmm.
So, and thank you to those who have already pledged your support and who we met. Thank you.
Do you want to speak? Thank you. The events that they have put on have been really phenomenal. And, oops, you want me to? They're really phenomenal and are exactly what I think can change the city. So I encourage you to support their efforts. We have Carol from the Ducktown Neighborhood Association, and I believe that is it. Is there anyone else planning to speak? From Chelsea. I'm sorry.
Venice Park.
First ward. I asked Libby. Yeah. Okay. Come on, Carol. Come on up from Chelsea. And I know you guys have done some fundraising through events, which I think is a great idea for the associations to get some funding in.
I'll make this very brief. Chelsea Neighborhood Association is the largest association in Atlantic City. We cover the 5th, 6th, and part of the 4th ward. And I think our strongest activity is our scholarship foundation that we give scholarships to students that are graduating from Atlantic City or Holy Spirit that live in the city of Atlantic City. And here with me today also from our board is Sharon Alloy and Dawn Barrow-Marich and Ann, who just left. And for years, I wish Ann was still here, because it was even before, I've been on the board for probably 18 years. And as long as I've been on the board, I've been going to the Chelsea Neighborhood fundraising events that were always held at the Tropicana. And it was a big event where we would have honorees and we'd sell tickets and we'd raise a lot of money. And all the money that we raised, we gave it back to the scholarships. And we either gave $1,000 scholarships or $500 scholarships, book scholarships. It would depend on how much money we raised. We ran into a situation the year before Hurricane Sandy. There was a Local 54 strike, and we had to cancel our event. And then the next year was Hurricane Sandy. And then the next year, our treasurer who ran it passed away. So there was like 3 years where we didn't have the ability to do the fundraising. However, we had enough in the bank that we could still continue with giving out the smaller scholarships. Then we started 2 years ago with a new program, or a new fundraiser called The Taste of Chelsea. And we had all restaurants. The first year we had 12. I think the second year we had 10 or 11 restaurants that participated, where they all came to the Chelsea Hotel. And we charged, it was a small fee, it was only $35 to come in. We had a silent auction and a Chinese auction, and we continued to raise enough money to give away anywhere between 3 to 5 scholarships. We have a scholarship that we do with Atlantic Cape Community College, which is specifically for the hospitality industry, somebody going in for hospitality. And then Ann Rosenberg actually runs the scholarship committee, and she works with the guidance counselors in all the schools. And the students have to present a paper, and we review them, and we score them, and then whoever comes up with the highest score, for as many as we're going to give away, have the opportunity to get the scholarships from the Chelsea Neighborhood Association. And that's something that we look forward to continue to do. And last night at our board meeting, Ann presented the Arts Foundation project that's going on, the 48 blocks, and we're going to participate in that and have you come and speak at one of our meetings. The Civic Associations have a group, we're called the Civic Association of Atlantic City United, and we've been active with the city and with Elizabeth in coming in and giving our inputs into different things that are going on in City Hall and throughout the city. So we're looking forward to continue to do that, and I hope to see you all at our next Taste of Chelsea. Thank you.
We should be sure to post that on This Is AC. Okay, Augusta Garrett is with the Venice Park Civic Association, and they've been really active with our abandoned properties and a lot of other projects.
Yeah. With the Venice Park Civic Association, we do pretty much the same with everyone else as far as the neighborhood, you know, coming together. But basically this year we got a grant from AtlanticCare, and with the help of Cookie Till, who told us how to use the money great, we're working with the fireman and the policeman, who's going to help us build our bins as well. So we want to work with them. And also we're partnering with the young girls in the neighborhood. It's called Diamonds in the Rough. And that's what we're trying to do, bring the kids in as well, and using the Venice Park Civic Association to bring the whole neighborhood together. These young ladies, they already have an organization, but what we're going to do is the neighbors are going to help with them, teaching them how to, you know, seed, because everything's going to be coming from seeds. One of our neighbors has donated the land. We're painting the fence different colors so we can also beautify the neighborhood at the same time. You know, and this is the initiative more than anything, is trying to bring everybody together. We want to bring the police in to associate with these kids. We want to bring the parents in to teach them as well. And the girls are very excited, and all of the neighbors as well are excited about it. We also now talking with the arts community, because we're going to have our grand opening. And when we have the grand opening, we're going to try to do it in association with when they have the thing as well at the same time. So, you know, we're using the money very well. You know, SJTA has come with us as far as new signage. We already have our sign ready and everything of that sort. So we're really looking for a nice, you know, opening of it. The guy, somebody has also donated a greenhouse. So it's going to be very nice, and I think it's going to not only start us in that neighborhood to improve right this neighborhood, but after that we're going to go next to the next person and tell him it's time for you to clean up your lot as well.
Wow, that is really exciting. I have a video that I'm going to show after we take public comments. I just wanted to let you know, I know some people have to head back to work, but it's a 20-minute video. It's the speaker that was at this NeighborWorks conference. They have a TED talk about organizing your neighborhood. It's actually really funny and very creative ideas of getting things done. And he talks about how he went to the city to try and get something done, and it pretty much broke every single law they had, but they did it anyway. And it's just very clever how they got things done. So comments, questions about how we can activate, or does anyone have questions for any of the neighborhood groups?
Could I just say one thing I forgot to say?
Yes.
Sheila, are you still here?
Sheila?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
The mural, I've done some research on it, and I do know who painted it. And one of the people, it was a team of youth in, I think, 96. And one of the people on the team was Kadir Nelson. I don't know if people in the room know who he is, but he is now a famous artist who's done several covers of The New Yorker, and is really, he wasn't born here, he didn't live here. He was born in Washington, D.C., but he has relatives in town. And so I'm hoping that I can get in touch with him and maybe learn more about some of the other elements that are in there.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. We should talk more about it.
That's great. Other questions, comments?
One thing I forgot to say, and I'm very sorry about this, but the Chelsea neighborhood is very excited about the Stockton College deciding to make their home in the Chelsea neighborhood. So we're looking forward to working with you for years to come.
Yes, welcome Stockton. You want to say anything?
It's a good introduction. I'm Joe Lubenstein. I teach anthropology. My colleague, excuse me, I'm getting over a cold. Laurie Green also, anthropology at Stockton. But our program, again, with the support of the president, is spending a lot of time on the transition of Stockton University into the neighborhood where they're building. Evan and other people actually in the room are going to be speaking. Carol, to my senior seminar, has been spending a year studying the impact, the possible impacts of Stockton University in the neighborhood on a number of different ways. We've developed a lot of data, and we're going to spend the entire spring term doing the same. Now, one of the reasons I'm here is also that one of their final projects is actually to partner with a community organization to develop a Stockton community organization collaborative public project. So I've been taking lots of notes and get ready for a call from each one of the students who 25% of their grade. So we're very excited about coming into Atlantic City. Lots of challenges. I'm on several committees trying to affect the transition, but I can assure you, as Dean Honecker said, the president is 100% behind the move. He's very, very excited and really does want to work with many, many of the community organizations. So that's what I'll be doing for the next couple of years, working with Brian, working with Lori, Evan, and Carol, and others. If you go on the website, if you have an idea, my students would love to work with you. I mean, sociology and anthropology students spend a lot of their time on community engagement. That's part of why they major in our program. So if you want to get in touch with me, Joe Lubenstein, on the website, I'm happy to get back to you.
That's great. Thank you.
I want to thank Stockton. Stockton has been a great supporter of the Taste of Chelsea. The first year we did it, they were a silver sponsor, and thank God last year they were a platinum sponsor. So thank you for that, and we're looking forward to working with you.
Okay.
One last thing. We're also, one of the things that I do is put in community gardens, by the way.
Yes.
And so we're putting a big community garden on the campus. But I'm trying to find, and there are real estate people here,
right.
We are looking for a lot. We have a very good environmental and sustainability programs at the university, along with Associate Ann. If someone could help me identify...
I have one for you.
We got lots of them.
We know there are lots. The question is whether
it's
we're allowed to
right.
build on them.
Yes.
But we have a lot of expertise at the university. The people running sustainability, environmental science, we have an organic garden, we have a community garden now. We would love to put in a large community garden that addresses the needs of the neighborhood. We want to plant things that restaurants and residents will use, depending on the kinds of folks that live in those neighborhoods. So please, again, if you have them, if you know, or you own a lot, joe.rubenstein@stockton.edu.
All right, I'm going to start the video, and then if anyone needs to chit-chat, just go out in the hallway, and I'll stay after as well.